Listening Library presents History Smashers, The Underground Railroad by Kate Messner and Gwendolyn Hooks. Read for you by Reginald James. You've probably heard stories about the Underground Railroad, the secret network of helpers who provided aid to people escaping from slavery. Tales from this chapter of American history are often full of excitement, with freedom seekers racing through the darkness, lanterns hung in windows, and hidden rooms with sneaky getaway tunnels. Maybe you've read about Harriet Tubman, who escaped from slavery and then led hundreds of others to do the same. Or Quaker families who risked everything to help, breaking laws they knew were unjust. But only some of those stories are true. People really did escape from slavery. In the first half of the 19th century, thousands found their way to freedom every year. And some of them did get help, but not from a super-organized national group that provided detailed maps of safe houses. Instead, they found shelter with people who were part of loosely connected anti-slavery networks, or they got unexpected aid from people who weren't associated with those groups at all. Some of the most heroic helpers were left out of history books entirely, while others claimed more credit than they deserved. And most people who escaped from slavery had to do it on their own, with courage, cleverness, and determination. The true story of the Underground Railroad involves a lot more than nighttime escapes and secret rooms. It's a story of resistance and resilience, one that begins even before the first enslaved people were brought to the Americas. 1. How slavery came to America. A true history of slavery and resistance begins with the story of the people who were enslaved. Before Africans were taken to the Americas, they lived rich and varied lives as citizens of many different nations. They crafted tools and weapons out of iron and made clothing from the woven fibers of palm leaves. Those who lived near the ocean fished and made salt by boiling seawater in clay jars. Other African people were farmers. They grew rice, yams, and a kind of grain called millet. They raised oxen, cows, horses, pigs, goats, and dogs. They brought their crops and animals to huge markets where thousands of people came to find the goods their families needed. Africa had vibrant economies and organized governments. Even in big kingdoms, many people were involved in decision-making. The kingdoms of Africa had figured out a thing or two about democracy before the United States of America was even a thought, much less a nation on a map. All that time, African people were making art and developing scientific ideas. They built several great, huge libraries and passed down knowledge from generation to generation. Researchers have rediscovered thousands of ancient African manuscripts focused on everything from religion to mathematics to astronomy. Slavery was also part of life in Africa, and that comes as a surprise to some people. But America didn't invent slavery. The practice goes all the way back to ancient Greece and Rome, and Africa too. Historically, people hadn't been enslaved based on the color of their skin. In ancient times, slavery was most often a way to take advantage of those who had been captured during war. That began to change in the 1400s. When Portugal started bringing enslaved people from Africa to Europe. You might be wondering how anyone could justify stealing people away from their homes and forcing them to work on another continent, even way back then. Europeans tried to justify it by claiming that African people were inferior to people from Europe. A Portuguese writer likely helped that idea along. Gomes Ianes de Zurara was a royal chronicler, which meant he was in charge of writing the official history of his nation. He wrote that African people were living like beasts, without any custom of reasonable beings. He said that if people weren't living peacefully under a government with laws, they really weren't people at all. So it was fine to enslave them. We know none of that was true. African people had kingdoms and thriving economies, along with great knowledge of science, math, and architecture. Many people in Europe certainly knew that too. But the racist idea that Africans were somehow inferior took hold. Other Europeans wrote similar things. For centuries, the works of Europeans erased the real history of African people and replaced it with one that would justify their enslavement. At first, this new slave trade mostly brought African people to Portugal and Spain. Then Christopher Columbus came along. There are enough myths about Columbus to fill an entire book. But for now, it's enough to know that his explorations opened the door on a whole new era of enslavement. At first, Columbus was sending enslaved people from the Caribbean back to Europe. These were Taino men and women he'd captured from the islands where they'd lived their whole lives. The Spanish enslaved native people and forced them to work in the Caribbean too, in gold mines on the island of Hispaniola. When those early European explorers arrived in the Americas, they brought along diseases. Native people had no immunity to the new germs, so smallpox and other illnesses ravaged Hispaniola. Less than 20 years after the arrival of Columbus, the native population had dropped from as many as 3 million to just about 25,000 who were still able to work. That's when the Spanish began bringing enslaved people across the ocean, a practice that was marked by cruelty and brutality at every stage. In 1510, King Ferdinand II gave his approval for 50 enslaved African people to be sent from Spain to Hispaniola to work in the gold mines. 3 weeks later, the king ordered another 200 enslaved people to be shipped across the sea under cramped, filthy conditions and forced to work in the mines. This was the beginning of the Atlantic slave trade. Soon, slave traders would begin capturing people in Africa and taking them straight to the Caribbean. Over the next 350 years, 12.5 million African people were sold into slavery in the Americas. The story of Handsome John. You might assume that every black person who traveled to the Americas was enslaved, but that wasn't the case. Some came as free men, like Juan Garrido, who set sail for the Caribbean on a Spanish ship in the early 1500s, when he was just 15 years old. Garrido's nickname was Handsome John. We don't have pictures of him from that time period, so you'll have to imagine him to decide if the name fit. It's not clear how Garrido ended up joining the Spanish. Some historians think he may have been the son of an African king who gave him the job of doing business with the Europeans. It's also possible that he was enslaved and joined the Spanish soldiers in exchange for freedom. Garrido spent 6 years in Hispaniola before he went with explorer Juan Ponce de Leon on a mission to search for gold. They traveled to Puerto Rico and later landed on the peninsula we now call Florida. They claimed it for Spain, but the Calusa people, whose ancestors had lived there for thousands of years, forced them to leave. Garrido also sailed with Hernan Cortes, a Spanish conquistador, or conqueror, who invaded Mexico and attacked the Aztec people in 1519. Later, Garrido returned to Florida with Ponce de Leon and a couple hundred settlers, hoping to set up a colony. Native people fought them off again, this time fatally wounding Ponce de Leon. Garrido escaped and continued to serve with the Spanish. The slave trade grew so quickly that part of West Africa became known as the Slave Coast, a 200-mile-long stretch that included the modern-day nations of Togo, Benin, and Nigeria. African rulers and merchants made deals with slave traders, sometimes selling their own people into slavery across the sea. The trade increased with the growth of the sugar industry in Brazil and the Caribbean. Sugar plantations required a lot of labor. As the slave trade grew, the Dutch and the English were also colonizing North America, invading lands that had been home to native people for generations. They wanted free labor, and merchants eager to make money jumped at the chance to provide it. By 1740, Great Britain was sending more than 30 slave ships to Africa each year, enslaving tens of thousands of people and forcing them on a nightmare journey across the sea. The power of words. One of the ways white Europeans and Americans tried to justify slavery was by dehumanizing the people they enslaved, talking about them as if they weren't people at all. Fugitive slave advertisements.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.